Coming up on Need to Know Rochester, state legislators in our area join me to reflect on the highlights and lowlights of the past legislative session. We'll also discuss what's next for some high-profile bills that failed to pass once again. Also on the show, we'll meet a London-based pianist and singer who has been described as performing with gritty elegance and sparkling originality. He's in our area for the Xerox Rochester International Jazz Festival. And we'll learn about a family farm working to help young people with autism develop self-help and life skills. The farm could possibly receive a major makeover. We have the details. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know Rochester.
Rochester's news magazine since 1997. This is Need to Know Rochester.
Hello, I'm Hélène Biandudi Hofer, and thanks for joining me for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. The passage of medical marijuana, a package of bills to combat the rise in heroin, and an increase in education aid are some of the winners in this year's state legislative session. But there are also several losers, in particular, a number of high-profile bills, some a few votes away from gaining passage. So what happened with the items still left on the table? And where do our state legislators go from here in addressing the issues that matter to their constituents? Joining me now to talk highlights and lowlights of this year's session is Assembly Minority Leader Brian Kolb and Assemblyman Harry Bronson. And thank you both for being here.
Pleasure.
So I mentioned some of the big ones, medical marijuana, the increase in education aid, and a package of anti-heroin bills. But there are also bills that did not make the cut. And I want to get your idea. I know some of them might have been held up by the state Senate. I heard some like lawmakers say less important bills may have pushed these to the side. But I want to get your take. What's the one bill important to each of you that did not pass this legislative session, and why this bill in particular?
Who would you like to go first?
We start with you, Brian.
Well, that would have to be Brittany's law for me. This is a bill that's passed the Senate for the last 5 years, overwhelmingly bipartisan support, less than, I think, five no votes altogether. That bill, with a Assembly Democrat majority sponsor, has not moved out of committee. And it's a bill that basically creates a registry for violent offenders. I had two constituents in my district in 2009 murdered, a 12-year-old girl, Brittany Pascalacqua, and her mother, Helen Bouchel. And this bill, and I co-sponsored this bill, and I felt that this is one real miss by the state assembly that we should have voted on.
What about you, Harry?
Certainly, I think that we should have done more with the public finance aspect of legislation this year. You know, we had an agreement in the budget that limited it only to the controller's race. Right. And I see public finance as an important issue because it encourages members within our state to become more involved in politics. It forces candidates to go out and get small donations from many, many people, not only in their district, but throughout the state, but to focus on their district, to get people engaged in politics. We don't have enough people engaged in government and engaged in politics, so I think public finance would be real important for us to ultimately get passed.
I'm curious to know how you decide which legislation to go to bat for. I mean, is it based solely on your constituents, or is it a personal issue? Is it connected to your morals and your values? What is it?
Well, for me, it's all of that. You know, there's certain things that our constituents want us to look at, and there's different constituency groups, obviously, within our districts.
Right.
But certainly there could be other issues that are important to us, but also may have a local connection, like when I talked about Brittany's Law. Their family, led by Dale Driscoll, came to Albany, participated. So it's a personal connection because of the, you know, I'm a father of three children, and so I can relate at that level, but also from a victim's level to looking out for them. So I think there's all sorts of things that enter into the equation. So there's no really one thing or another that at least tilts the scale for me.
I would agree with that. It's a personal situation. For instance, with medical marijuana, I, at one point when I first moved to the city of Rochester, I had a housemate who was suffering from ovarian cancer, and unfortunately she's no longer with us. And if we had medical marijuana passed at the time she was going through many of the treatments that she was having to address her cancer, it would have helped her tremendously. So that personal connection. Local officials here also bring pieces of legislation to us. For instance, in the town of Henrietta, which I represent, the town supervisor brought to myself and the senator that represents that area a tax rebate program that we got passed in both houses and is going to the governor. Then it's also advocates who are fighting for something. Injured workers brought to my attention the desire to allow acupuncture through the workers' comp system by licensed acupuncturist. That's another bill that I passed last year, got vetoed. We made some adjustments to it. This year it got passed again. So all those things bring issues to our attention, and then we try to make it work at the legislature level.
Well, let me say this. Some may argue that voting to make yogurt the state's official snack, or passing a bill to outlaw tattooing or piercing cats or dogs seemed to block the passage of some key bills that were really big in the media. I'm talking about public campaign financing. You mentioned that. A higher minimum wage. The New York Dream Act, which would give undocumented students an extension of financial aid. And these are all things that Governor Cuomo promised the Working Families Party, and they did not get passed. And I understand that there was some holdup in the state Senate with some of these items, but what are your thoughts on these major bills, and why didn't they pass? I mean, were there inconsistencies? Were there questions? The governor often says the devil's in the details, and it come down to that.
Well, in some cases, if you talk about the Dream Act passed in the state assembly and it didn't move forward in the Senate, it's because the votes aren't there to move it. That is a pretty much a cut and dry. If you don't have votes to pass a bill, regardless of the topic, it's not going to move. In some cases, it's politics. For instance, when you didn't mention Women's Equality Act.
Right, I'm getting there, that's right.
There was one bill in the assembly that passed that had 10 platforms in it. Well, in the Senate, they've passed 9 out of 10. So here you have agreement in the assembly, 9 plus 1. 9 in the Senate, and we didn't pass the other 9. So we should have passed the independent 9 different planks, because there was support on both sides, bipartisan. But the controversial piece on abortion expansion was what the Senate was having trouble getting votes on. So in the assembly, we should have taken up the 9 individual planks. For instance, and they're all sponsored by majority members, Amy Paulin from Westchester County sponsored a bill dealing with human trafficking.
Right.
And there it sits because of politics. They're trying to use this issue for election year over in the Senate because of the abortion piece not moving in the Senate. Yeah. So there's different factors that go in all the time.
Well, you know, each of the houses look at the big ticket items. Oftentimes those are agendas that are being moved and pushed by the governor. Sometimes they're not. We look at those big ticket items, but then we also move other bills that are important to individual members. And you have to make sure that you have the votes to get bills passed. And you also have to make sure that you're making the right policy decision for the people of the state of New York. Women's Equality Act. I think the right policy decision is to pass all 10 elements of the Women's Equality Act. We have in the past, in the assembly, passed those individual bills repeatedly without having success in the past. So to blame just the one aspect, the reproductive rights aspect, on the failure of Women's Equality Act, I think misses the real issue here. And that is, we have to make the right policy decisions, and we have to persuade others to vote for the pieces that we want to get voted for. And I think in the Women's Equality Act, that should be the whole thing. The Dream Act is another example. It failed in the New York State Senate. And then we passed it again in the assembly after it failed to make it a live bill yet again, yet it got blocked in the New York State Senate. So we've got to make sure that we get the votes there and just keep pushing for the right policy decisions.
I want to go back to women's equality, because at first it was this all or nothing thing. There are 10 planks, as you mentioned, sex trafficking for one. There was laws requiring equal pay for equal work, ending sexual harassment on the job. And Donna Lieberman, executive director of the New York Civil Liberties Union, said 9 out of the 10 provide important protections for women in the community and at the workplace. And there was was this thing, you know, towards the end of the session, while there was this push all or nothing, then there was this idea, well, maybe we can take some of these, like maybe we can do 9 out of the 10. And why couldn't, I mean, the legislature as a whole, it's you mentioned, you know, it comes down to votes, but it was so close. How did the 9 not work its way through?
Let me put it this way. That 10-point package was a compromised, negotiated package to try to put it all together. Some of those other areas, the human trafficking, the anti-discrimination piece of it, the equal pay piece of it, those were all, in my perspective, watered down components so that we could get the whole package passed. If folks want to go back and pass those individual ones that would have the full protection, then possibly we could do that. But I think keeping them all together is the compromised approach that we should take.
I need a lot more time with both of you, and unfortunately I don't have it today, but I trust that you'll both come back and spend some time with me again. Assemblyman Harry Bronson and Assembly Minority Leader Brian Cole, thank you so much for your time today. You can always get the latest news from Albany from WXXI's Capitol Bureau correspondent Karen DeWitt. Check out her reports. They're on our website, WXXINews.org, and click on the Capitol Bureau link. You can also follow Karen on Twitter at KDeWitt7. London-based pianist and singer Jonathan G has been called one of Europe's leading trio specialists. He has established musical ties around the globe, performing throughout Europe, China, Cameroon, and Singapore, among other stops, including Rochester. You may have seen his performances at Christ Church on Wednesday for the Xerox Rochester International Jazz Festival. He also served as a guest musician for a jazz workshop for young musicians this week, teaching youngsters how to improve their craft. So before he ventures off yet again to travel and perform in a jaw-dropping destination somewhere in the world, Jonathan G joins us in the studio, and it's great to have you here.
Thank you.
So more than 20 years ago, Jonathan, you were named most promising newcomer by the British Jazz Awards. And since that time, I understand that you have made quite a reputation for yourself and in Europe, working with your trios and also here in the United States. But first, I want to know about life for Jonathan G before being called a rising star. So tell me a little bit about your background, where you grew up and how you got into piano.
Well, I grew up in London, and I studied classical piano when I was very young, but quite quickly switched to rock guitar. So I was more of a rock guitarist. And just getting into improvising and jamming, that was like my whole thing. And then I sort of shifted slightly and studied medieval history at university for a short period. But the music took over, and the thing about jazz is, you know, improvising in rock is great, but at the piano, the whole history of jazz piano, the language, is an astonishing legacy of America, and it's an amazing music. And so I got the jazz bug.
So how did jazz hook you? What is it about the music and that you love?
It was just the amazing combination of groove and harmony, yeah, like epitomized by, you know, the great musicians like Oscar Peterson and Thelonious Monk. When I was growing up, Oscar Peterson had a TV show. It was just about the only jazz you heard on TV in the UK. And he's an amazing presenter of jazz, an amazing musician himself, and then he'd have great guests on, and he just drew us in. A lot of my generation of jazz pianists in Britain watched Oscar Peterson on TV and thought, that looked, you know, in a whole world of rock, that was an amazing little gem. And it got me improvising on the piano. And after that, you know, you go, you know, you hear records and you just check out Miles Davis, John Coltrane, Bill Evans. And then once you're in, and then you're just getting on with it, really.
Tell me about the people, the experiences and your life early on in your career that you believe have contributed to your longevity as an artist. Because not everybody who sets out to make a living in this field is actually able to do it. So how are you?
Number one, I think when I started, I always wanted to be learning. And also the thing about the great jazz musicians is, I remember seeing an interview with Sonny Rollins. He's basically said, it's the greatest music in the world because you're trying to play. The whole point of jazz is to be in the moment. And if you can really focus on being in the moment every time you play, it's going to stay fresh.
Wow. I want to learn a little bit more, because I mentioned this. You are called one of Europe's leading trio specialists. So how did you come about leading and working with jazz trios as opposed to focusing on the solo artist track?
Well, first of all, I love being in bands. I love the interaction, particularly from the piano, particularly with drums. I just, because I approach the piano from quite a drum point of view, and I feel like I'm in a percussion section a lot of the time. But the simplest thing is, I like playing the tune. And if you're in a trio, then you're leading the melody. If you're in a quartet, then often the saxophone's leading the melody. And I compose a lot of my own music, and I like to play my own music. And yeah, basically, I get to play the tune, so that's why I really like playing trio.
Well, you were called Jazz Wise Magazine in regards to your album Dragonfly.
Yeah.
They said, G has a persuasively lucid touch and a fast-talking intensity that endows his playing with gritty elegance, breathlessly sparkling originality. I've never heard gritty and elegant used in such a way before. So how do you approach your work and create that, create gritty elegance?
I think... That's amazing. I haven't thought about that. But what they might mean by gritty elegance, they probably mean that I get right inside the groove, but keep it flowing at the same time. I presume that's what they're saying.
Well, I know that people don't want to hear me talk. They want to hear you perform. So
Okay. We're
going to get an opportunity to hear you in just a moment. Right. And I want to remind our viewers that you can check out coverage of the Jazz Festival. We are there, WXXINews.com. Go to the website and click on the link, Jazz Festival. Jazz pianist and singer Jonathan G, thank you for joining me today. And hopefully, we'll see you back at the Jazz Festival next year. Check out more of Jonathan's music on his website, jonathangtrio.co.uk. My next guest is a woman with a dream that not only involves helping her autistic brother, but young adults throughout the Greater Rochester area with developmental disabilities. That dream, turning a family farm in Spencerport into an agricultural community where people can build what she calls forever sustainable lives. And it turns out she's a step closer to making that dream a reality. Her nonprofit, Homesteads for Hope, is a semifinalist in the Ultimate Neighborhood Give Back Challenge. Now that's a nationwide search for people and organizations leading projects to make their neighborhoods a better place. And joining me to share more about the project is Jenny Ray Brongo, founder and president of Homesteads for Hope. And thank you for being here.
Hello.
So Jenny Ray, you have had quite an interesting life path. And I understand when you were 7 years old, your dad gave you a typewriter and said, here, you're doing my billing. And he puts you to work. Yep. And then you later went on to engineering school and then came back to the family business and worked for it. And then after an unfortunate event, you ended up taking over the family business. Tell me a little bit about that.
Yep, 2 months exactly when I graduated from Alfred State College in construction management engineering, I came home with big dreams with my father to basically run a gravel pit, and we were into all about sustainability and construction recycling, and we wanted to build a group home for my brother Chucky because we just spent 4 years out of state with him and he needed a placement back in New York State. So 2 months out of graduating, he passed away, and I've renovated my whole entire business, and I try to do wholesale landscape supply. I partner with our local BOCES, and I project manage the heavy equipment program. They come to my gravel pit property of 16 acres, and they learn the most authentic learning experience possible.
So I want you to tell me about this, your brother Chucky, and this mission that you have for him. And I want to know, how did everything align for you in such a way to trigger this aha moment of sorts that led you to launch the nonprofit Homesteads for Hope?
It's been years. It's been absolute years. We just wanted to do something to give back for Chucky. And then I thought about the future and like my kids and people I went to school with, their children, and the future of autism. It's now 1 in 68. And then the 2020 diagnosis is even worse. So I wanted to do something right here in my community to think big. And my uncle, he owns this one-of-a-kind, beautiful 55-acre farm. He's been there since like the 40s and 50s, farming it with my entire family.
Wow.
And he stays there, and he's retired now. And I took my brother there, and we just started walking around. It's located on the historic Erie Canal, and it's just beautiful. And we looked in the sunflower fields, and he was just mesmerized by everything. And the sensory that was happening was just unbelievable. And I just knew at that moment, like, wow, this is such a beautiful place. Like, it's a community, it's agriculture. It's in his blood, so this might be his forever home. So I came up with this idea that he needs to have a meaningful lifestyle. He needs to be a contributing member of society, and he needs to do something that's therapeutic, and what more therapeutic than horticulture? And we can utilize things on the farm to give back to the rest of the community. So I put this dream together, and it started with Homestead, which was just one house, mm-hmm. but now it's Homesteads. So multiple, I have this dream of an entire development.
And before we discuss the dreams that you have for Homesteads for Hope and this ultimate neighborhood give back challenge, I want to know, give me more details about the type of work that you're doing right now on the farm for young people with autism and developmental disabilities. What are the types of activities that they're getting involved in?
So it's very exciting. We're just 1 year out. May 2013, I founded this on paper. Now we're May 1st, we started a pilot program, and we're having kids come out and actually learn the trade of farming. Chucky is our pilot. He started with us putting the plastic down, poking all the holes, putting all the plants inside the holes and watching them grow. We're in the nurturing stage right now with our little baby tomatoes and everything. So he's working right out in the field. He goes there every day and he waters and stuff, but he also has a recreational opportunity. So he's enjoying the canal, he's going fishing. He's learning these little life skills. Every Sunday we have volunteer days, so I have lots of my past construction students come out, and the community comes out on Sundays and helps us do everything that we need to in between. Our goal for 2014 is to bring 10 farmers, 10 special farmers, onto the farm to give them a whole entire experience.
So how does a farm and this type of work, because I'm sure some people are curious, create that mentally stimulating and safe environment for your brother Chucky and for others?
I think it's a sensory. I think it's something that you consistently have to do enough. You're doing it with your hands. You have to see it. You have to smell it. And you really have to be intricate. And it's working with your hands. And they just love it. And it's consistent. And they have to do it one after another, which is a routine, which is very important with people with disabilities, especially autism. So it just keeps them connected to what they're doing. And it's keeping their minds busy. So they can do that in the greenhouse or out in the fields. And our future goals are to offer vocational trainings in this opportunity so that they can learn the job skills necessary to get back out in the community and have, you know, a full-time employment position.
And are you working with any area agencies that specialize in helping young people with autism and developmental disabilities with this effort?
You know, it's been 1 year, so there's a lot of talking going on. There's nothing fully happening at this moment, but I want the area agencies to realize that there's no competition, that this is in fact just a facility that we can all share together, that we can all utilize to benefit the consumers here in Rochester, New York, and Monroe County.
So as I mentioned before, you have big plans for Homesteads for Hope, and I know you eventually want to develop that group home type setting that you mentioned. But tell me, what is the vision? Because you've got this big ultimate give back challenge that you are a semifinalist for. What's the vision should you be the winner of that contest?
So the Ultimate Give Back Challenge is an opportunity to do something ultimate in your community that's going to give back full circle. And providing services and supports to our special needs individuals gives them an opportunity to give back to the rest of society. So we have a dream is to develop my uncle's barns. He has these historic 18th century barns that he's just maintained to the T. I mean, exteriors, outteriors, the floors, they're just beautiful. And we want to renovate them so we can utilize them year round with heat and make sure that they're weatherized. And we want to make a general store so that we can get these kids a nice little nooked place to work out of, plus a farm to table cafe so we can offer enterprises to give back to the community and back to the organization, and then a community classroom within so that we can hold events and hold certain type of activities, if it's anything from a movie night to yoga to just conferences.
We've got about 20 seconds left. What do the kids involved with Homesteads for Hope want to learn?
They want to learn how to be sustainable. They want to learn how to take care of themselves and give back to their community and have a meaningful lifestyle. And that's what this is all about.
Well, founder and president of Homesteads for Hope, Jenny Ray Barongo, thank you so much for joining me today. And you can help Jenny with her mission by voting for Homesteads for Hope and the Ultimate Neighborhood Give Back Challenge. So just go to the group's website, homesteadsforhope.com. It's on the screen, and click on the Vote Here link. Homesteadsforhope.org, and click on the Vote Here link. And this segment was part of WXXI's Move to Include. It's a partnership of WXXI and the Golisano Foundation, working with the community to lead change toward the inclusion of people with intellectual and physical disabilities. So discover how you can make a difference. Visit movetoinclude.org. And that is it for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Hélène Biandudi Hofer. Thank you for joining me on Thursday nights and throughout the weekend. And thank you for supporting news and public affairs programming on WXXI.